So within this selection of boards, myself and Ciarán are going to talk about aphid and BYDV control. One of the first issues around BYDV control in the last few years has been the emergence of knockdown resistance or pyrethroid resistance. It was first detected in Ireland in 2013, having previously been detected in the UK in 2012. The first thing we need to know about it is that within the Cytobia novinae or grain aphid family, the resistance gene is carried only on the SA3 clone. And when we say resistance, we're really referring to partial resistance because of the two genes that govern how sodium gate channels open and close in insects, the mutation is only on one of those genes. We refer to it as partial resistance. It's not full resistance, but in lab studies, what we've found is that between 40 to 50% of the aphids, the SA3 clone, that have this partial resistance will die. But that level of death and mortality did not necessarily equate to some of the issues we're seeing in the field, some of the issues we're seeing with BYDV control. So we went looking for additional mechanisms of resistance, and in lab studies what we found is that there are some geographic populations of the SA3 clone who have metabolic or have developed metabolic resistance. What metabolic resistance is, it's where the aphid produces an enzyme to help detoxify the pyrethroid once it comes into contact with it. When situations like that occur, about 70 to 80% of those aphids will survive and go on to reproduce. So that's a big issue in terms of BYDV management, because as the new populations are formed, as younger aphids come on, they then spread BYDV around the crop. In terms of how widespread it is in the country, we did surveys in 2016, 2017 and 2018. Within those surveys, we surveyed fields that had been treated with pyrethroids, fields that hadn't been treated at all, fields that had been treated with neonicotinoids, and fields that had been treated with both pyrethroids and neonicotinoids. What we found is that in 2016, about 54% of the Cytobia novinae that we found were the SA3 clone. This fell in 2017 to 25%, and subsequently was 20% in 2018. What we feel happened, and the explanation for this decrease, is that in 2015 and 2016, there was a greater uptake in the use of neonicotinoids by growers, and we feel that that might have helped in terms of reducing the level of resistant individuals we were finding. So in terms of what impact those resistant individuals may or may not be having in the field, I'll hand over to Ciarán.
Okay, so how bad can it be? This is a trial that was carried out in Cork in the autumn of 2016. The red squares here are where we have BYDV. Untreated, 39% BYDV infection. We've got in the yellow and in the blue here, we've got pyrethroid and seed treatments, and the yield difference between the treated and the untreated was 2.4 tonnes per hectare. But significantly in this site, there was no significant difference between pyrethroids and seed treatments. So the pyrethroids actually did a very good job on this site. But wind the clock forward 12 months, the same farm, the same sowing date, and we only had 2.6% BYDV in the untreated versus the 39% in the previous year. So that just goes to show the difference that the mild winter did and the impact that it had on BYDV control. So the next question is, what are we going to do in a post neonicotinoid era? So IPM, integrated pest management, is becoming increasingly important for us. So the first IPM measure that we can use is sowing date. So for autumn cereals, as we know, the earlier that we sow, the risk is much higher. So what we mean by early is mid to late September, the risk is the highest. As we move into October, the risk is lower, and obviously crops emerging after November would be the lowest risk. In spring cereals, the highest risk again is the later sowing. So crop sown in February and March would be a low risk. And then April and up to the end of April would obviously be a higher risk. In terms of control, we just have the pyrethroids available to us at the moment. So what the research is showing us in winter cereals is to apply an aphicide at the 2 to 3 leaf stage. Now this may need be repeated for earlier sown crops or in particularly mild winters. For spring cereals, the research is telling us that an application at the 4-leaf stage is the most effective and that there is no benefit in repeat applications. So that's the cultural control piece there in terms of sowing date, but also minimizing the green bridge is also a significant impact in terms of BYDV control, particularly in relation to spring crops where you have the carryover maybe of volunteers in the previous crop, providing a source of infection for the crop that you're going to sow. Also, and maybe further down the road, is variety selection. We can see differences between untreated varieties in Department of Agriculture trials, but as of yet, this is difficult to quantify and the impact. But the breeders would tell us that in 2 to 3 years' time, they are working on varieties that may have a certain tolerance or hopefully down the road, resistance. So the IPM doesn't finish once we have the crop sown. We also have the in-season IPM. So I suppose that starts with, first of all, it's monitoring and forecasting. So it would be the likes of towers that we're using here in Oak Park that monitor aphid flight. It's also visual assessments in the crop. If I've sown my crop in March and I'm looking in the crop, do I see aphids? You know, that monitoring that we have to do. Also, the in-season IPM measure would be the targeted application of insecticides. It's using insecticides on the days that we are at the timings that we know that will be most effective, which would be the 2 to 3 leaf stage in winter, in autumn cereals, and again at the 4 leaf stage in spring cereals. And again, it's using anti-resistance strategies, which is monitoring for control failure. It's getting into the crop 3 or 4 days after application. Do I see live aphids? Have I got good control? And that's assuming that I've done everything well in terms of the spraying day and the correct boom height and that as well. And I suppose finally, in terms of biocontrol, as you all came along the passage here today, you would have seen the arable margins. This is part of a research project that's going on at the moment to look at the impact that predators can have. And it's about trying to find that balance on our farms. And the arable margins will hopefully be a host for some of these predators. And that, again, is another IPM measure that we're looking at for the future control.